behind it, there's a lot of things we're shameful of. But really, without the truth side, you're not going to get to the reconciliation. And this is really what a lot of the poems reflect on. They also reflect on the spirit of resistance and resilience and survival. What the youth really discovered was how much they had in common coming from countries that have been colonized. So I'm going to introduce the youth, Raven Obe. You're going to stand up because we're going to have to present here. So Raven Obe. Raven is 18. She studies at Willis College, and she's of Algonquin, Cree, and Mohawk descent. She's also a published author.
I'll do the lights if you just frame the...
Adam Ahmed King, the baby of the group, he's 15. He goes to South Carleton High School, and this will actually be his first performance today. He is of mixed Iraqi, Arab, and First Nations descent. I believe it's Galbay. Is Geraldine here? Where's Geraldine? She here? Your family's not here yet? Is your family here yet? Okay, but your sister's not here yet. Okay. Oh, too bad. His sister's here, but Galbay First Nation. Okay. Next is our facilitator, Sarah Musa. She's Somali-Canadian. She's also an accomplished spoken word poet. She's performed at Urban Legends and really at different events across the city. And she's really committed to social justice issues. Next is Dustin Pilon Planer. He's of Ojibwe, Italian and French Canadian descent. He's a student at Milan Pilata High School in his 12th year. And his stage name is Disaster, and his spirit name is Thunder Spirit Walker. And last but not least, we have Alan Angel Desenga. She's Congolese Canadian, currently studying at Carleton University, and she also is very committed to social justice issues. Thank you. And right now they will be performing their group piece, which is called Who Are You?
Who are you?
Who am I? They say I am the angel of death, a bird of misery. I will take to give and give to take, for that I am a trickster. I have stolen fire to ignite the sun, then taken water to quench thirst when the heat became too much. I was even Odin's companion at a time when gods were powerful in Greece. I've lived many lives, that of a man, a twig, a child, and a dove. But for now, I am a woman. I am the raven.
Who are you?
Who am I? I am Adam King. Well, not really. My name is Ahmed Ali Hussein King. I bet the first thing that came to mind was that I'm a terrorist. Well, no, you're wrong. I'll tell you a story. The reason why I picked Adam King was because it was a common name. Not only that, but it was the first name on Earth. My Aboriginal name is Hawknose. The reason why they picked that is because I got a big nose.
Who are you?
When people look at me, they expect an exotic and complicated name. I am Sara Musa. My name has historical significance. For example, Sarah was the name of the wife of Prophet Abraham, and my last name is Musa, which is the name of Prophet Moses. Somalis seem to have trouble grasping the fact that my name is pronounced in the Arabic way, because usually, when you meet a Somali girl named Sarah, the way to pronounce her name is Sahara, and Musa would be pronounced Musa, but in English, that would be written as Muse. I get asked where I'm from like it's a question I've never been asked before. A child birthed into the land of the free with diasporic roots, I couldn't begin to tell you who I was or what made up my ethnic DNA. I'm a Muslim Canadian Somali. It's like the world has a problem with my very existence, as if knowing or rediscovering your identity is shameful. I speak on behalf of myself. I am me, no gimmicks. Who are you?
It depends which name you mean. My social documental name, the name I've been called all my life and turned my head to, every request and demand, compliment and criticism has been directed to this name, Dustin Mitchell Pilon-Plan. So it depends which name you mean. The name that gave me a surge of life the first time I heard it. The name I now hear in my dreams by which every spirit I meet calls me. the name that excites and terrifies me, that lifts my spirit, but also confuses the interior of my mind, because no one knows how this name describes the exterior of myself, Thunder Spirit Walker. So Dustin Pion Planner, that sounds normal, right? Coming from a huge Italian family, you'd think my dad would have a more Italian name. Pilon fits my mother's side, however, because she is half French. But in this case, half and half do not make a whole, because where does the native fit in? That is why I ventured around in the spirit world after smoking the sacred pipe to find Thunder Spirit Walker. Who am I? Who are you?
Who am I? Apparently I'm black. What is that? How do I go about being it? What does it mean? What is its history? So I'm filling out this form and it says, are you black, African, or African American? And I wonder, what am I? My mom always told me to speak. Speak who you are and stand fast in it. Be who you be and walk in it with pride. My name is Amoya Jelitsenga. Amoy, the roots and the Congo, the land of riches, the land of beauty. That's who we are.
This is my Aboriginal poem. For those who feel pain, I understand it's not a game. Those people should be ashamed. It's nothing you can forget. Those people should have regret. You're not their toy. You're not their pet. They thought you were bad. You have every right to be mad. It's heartbreaking. It's sad. Now, we're the ones to pay. They took our rights, and yet we still stay. It's time, it's still the same, each and every other day. Now let's gather around and pray. We've been told lies, the truth still hides. My grandmother, she still cries, because all her friends have died. She's had trouble telling me why. It's time to talk. We're somewhat free to walk. Elders are still in shock. It's something that hasn't stopped. I'll show you my heart, it's somewhat hard. They forced them to go to school, trust me, it wasn't cool. Taken from their homes, they've been tossed and thrown off their feet. If they resisted, they got beat, to the point where they lost their teeth. Let's hope this action doesn't repeat. We were kind, we helped them survive, but you didn't keep your word, you lied. They raped our women after they screamed and cried. They took their pride. This is a genocide. It's hard to believe both sides. It's hard to fight. This wasn't right. I'm sorry to speak out. I'm sorry to scream and pout. But it's time someone showed some doubt. This is the end. I'm sorry, people. I don't blame.
These are our experience in school poems. How is it when you try to learn the history of your people when history is white? Admittedly, I only started to care in grade 10, sitting in history class realizing Canadian history does not mean the history of this country's people. Canadian history starts with John A. Macdonald and continues with every other white prime minister, not including at all the Aboriginals who could not be part of their land's history because they were given no rights. Canadian history followed the lives of English and Frenchmen, so pardon my language when I say, Gawin de Kitsi, je n'ai aucune voix, I have no voice. I tried, mind you, to speak out against my teacher who refused what I wanted to be taught, but without a second thought, I remained caught and distraught within what the textbook said. I am drowning in a sea of useless knowledge, like food that makes you hungrier. I was growing impatient, so don't act surprised when I say I exploded. In my grade 11 Aboriginal class, taught by my Italian drama teacher, I was told things I was told when I was 10, the basics which don't mean a thing to me anymore, because I know more than my teacher. Like not every native follows the medicine wheel, not every native burns all four sacred medicines, and not every tribe has the same creation story. So excuse my rage when I'm forced to Google what I want to know and still don't get one straight answer. It pains me to know I know nothing. Even when I know more than some, I still know nothing. All I want to know is who I am and what my culture is. So forgive my ignorance of being native and not even knowing how.
The following is a letter, a lament of all my experiences in school systems. Despite the fact that the history of Indigenous peoples and peoples of African descent is trivialized and marginalized, while those of Europeans abstracted and reified as the ideal, I am learning to love myself, and I am and will forevermore be uncompromisingly black. Dear white people, there will come a day when lines will speak, when the society that you so proudly purport yourself having built will be revealed in its entirety. There will be no lies to shield you from the brutality of the pain you have inflicted on the African and Indigenous race, and your story of the great democracy you inherited from ancient Greek civilizations will be revealed as a myth. Dear white people, I am not, nor will I ever be white, so stop attempting to anglicize me via your school curriculum of half-truths and who's who in great whiteness. This Western capitalist democracy so far removed from savagery, as you like to call it, when so-called primitive peoples roam doing all sorts of backwards, exotic things that you speak of with such repulsion, then have the nerve to ask me to come exhibit my culture in front of the class, you can marvel at its mysteriousness. If I spoke the words of Patrice Lumumba, would it move you? If I told you how he was murdered in his body incinerated in acid by Western powers, forever after destabilizing the Congolese country after it secured its independence, how the Congo, my Congo, the richest country in the world by far none, is being looted, blind, and we die by thousands per day. Dear white people, the Portuguese for centuries prior to Belgian colonization stole human beings from my country. Alphonse I of the Congo Empire in 1526 wrote to the Portuguese king, each day the traitors are kidnapping our people, children of this country, sons of our nobles and vassals, even people of our own family. This corruption and depravity are so widespread that our land is entirely depopulated. So stop trying to instruct me on the greatness of your society. I know all about your democracy. I've seen the acts of so-called civilized seeping in the blood of my people. Dear white people, don't tokenize me. I will never assimilate. And don't speak to me of Plato. I could care less about his republic. I stand on the shoulders of giants. I'm Congolese, born in the heart of darkness where Portuguese pillaged and enslaved, and Belgians colonized and enslaved us, exchanged our hands as currencies, mutilated us and hung our decapitated genitals and heads on which palisades in the form of crosses. I will not spare you from this truth. This is our history. Even if you attempt to forget it, I will never. I am here because you were there. I am alive despite the fact that slave traders and colonialists decimated the Congolese population by the millions. My family survived enslavement, colonization, genocide, and war, and still we rise in concrete jungles of your inner cities, aware yet oblivious to your history books, where Africa and the monolithic African is a problem to be solved. As you exalt yourself because of the developmental aid you render, as my country remains indebted to those who colonized us before, in the words of Thomas Sankara, debt is neocolonialism, in which colonizers transform themselves into technical assistants. We should better say technical assassins. We cannot repay because we don't have any means to do so. We cannot repay because we are not responsible for this debt. We cannot repay but the others owe us what the greatest wealth can never repay. That is blood debt. Our blood has flowed. As you gender in African countries that's completely bereft without your governance, never mentioning your complicity in our underdevelopment. The human rights you once abolished but now consider pivotal aspects of your society, but up until the late 20th century were nyamas, animals, Negroes, so I will never praise you and your laws cannot affirm my humanity. And whether you admit to or refuse to your complicity in our condition, we exist. And if ever we are to exist together by animosity, a true account of history needs to be taught. Dear white people, listen. Negro is not an anthropological term, it's a slave one. Dear white people, Columbus Day should not be celebrated, but celebrate away, because there will come a day when lines will speak, when the society that you so proudly purport yourself having built will be revealed in its entirety. There will be no lies to shield you from the brutality of the pain you have inflicted on the African indigenous race. And your story to the great democracy you inherited from ancient Greek civilizations will be revealed as a myth.
So this is a separate piece I wrote on the problems or the issues I have with following my native roots but looking white. Am I not native? By the government standard, I am not. But what relevancy does this have compared to how I feel? But is it enough to feel native? They say don't judge a book by its cover. And I guess my cover reads like a simple white boy. But if you bothered to read my story, you would find an intertwined pattern of visions, teachings, and ceremony experiences that make me feel native. I try to learn all I can to be accepted. So imagine my devastation when someone who knows nothing about their culture and abuses drugs and is filled to the brim with disrespect is accepted more than I because they look native. These same people who would sell their purebred roots if possible criticize me for having only 1/8 native blood. Though they do not know it is that 1/8 of my blood that boils. Whenever I am enraged, overjoyed, depressed, or lost, my native side is where I turn, because I do not know what it means to be French, or what it means to be Italian, especially since I've been judged for having these roots as well, for the Italian and French helped in the assimilation of the natives. So since there is more of these in me, I must not be native. 1/8 doesn't count, especially when you have those treacherous blood in you, they say. As if it's my fault native teachings are the ones I've been given, with an atheist father, and a mother who is so Christian it hurts me to accept what she believes, as it pains her to know I believe in spirits that roam the land, and I do not believe I should try to live like Jesus, because it's already hard enough trying to live like me. When I get profiled as white, and describe myself as native, it's a constant battle. Two worlds are warring in me, and both sides are losing. None of the martyr in me shows my conviction. I hang around natives, hear their stories of racism, and I can't relate. I hear white people talk badly of natives, and I still can't relate. Is there really a solution that I can create? How do I live with this ongoing debate? Is there even a way to have a clean slate? When I look at the sky, I can't believe that this is my fate. I'm just gonna have to give up at this rate. I need now more than ever to break through this gate. To be or not to be? That is the question that haunts me every day. I know not if I am worthy to call myself native. Not sure if it's really my choice, but if it means anything when I use my own voice, then yes. I believe with all my heart I am worthy. Even if I'm the only one in the world who does, it's enough to get to tomorrow, when once again, I go to battle with myself. And again, the native blood, my native blood, will boil with the hunger for victory. Yeah.
My poem is called As the Battle Rages On.
Well, hey, yo.
There was a savage beauty about her. Tan skin, high cheekbones, almond shaped eyes, seemingly hiding the answer to whichever secret she was keeping. Her secret was the same as many, scars hidden to the naked eye, ones that would never heal, yet that she hadn't endured directly. Mother and grandmother, generations beyond, had been the ones to suffer at the hands of ignorance. Despite the treaties, the closure of these abominations, money handed out, nothing would heal the scars left behind. Things would never be the same. She bore the battle wounds her elders bestowed upon her as a memory of her heritage. You mustn't forget, Kokum had said, for your children and grandchildren will bear the same markings, a simple reminder which cannot be forgotten. The battle will never cease as long as the scars remain. Gotch.
This is our final piece. It is a poem that was written by two of our performers, Angel and Dustin. Angel and Dustin.
I know why the caged bird sings. Even in war zones at our classrooms, a battleground, I stand armed with my blackness on one hand and my hope in the other. The teacher stands with a whiteness, all enveloping, all around me like air, like the poverty that cracked open concrete pavements in outer cities where dreams were swallowed whole. You wouldn't know, sir. You wouldn't know, ma'am, my pain. But it's okay. I still hope. I still believe in the beauty of blackness, even if the teacher stands with her arsenals of half-truths, prejudices, and rationalizations under a guise of righteousness. Lord, have mercy. It's enveloping all around me like air. I sit waiting to exhale, waiting to be free, but I know why the cage bird sings. I know the founding fathers were alive. I know Christopher Columbus didn't discover the Americas, and I know black is beautiful. And I know you can never have justice on stolen land.
So why still do we battle an uphill war if not for the hope we carry that one day the cages will be blown apart, releasing our spirits, giving us the freedom we need to succeed? Victory comes not with the other side defeated, but only when both sides come out for better, bearing more knowledge than ever before. We fight against history, denying the founding fathers their right of way because we know no country was founded, it was taken over. And some say we can never have justice on stolen land, but I believe as long as pride runs through the veins of those who cling to their culture, that the other cities can be rebuilt, and soon they will tower over the buildings meant to keep us imprisoned. You cannot contain our souls, so instead contain your criticism, so that all may be equal in the eyes of all.
Someday we'll both put our weapons down, your white gun and my black slingshot, and we'll just lay here as human beings, studying, learning, being, together. But not until you put down your lives, not until you tell the truth, not until you give back what you took, until then, this will always be a war zone. And I won't put away my slingshot until you take the bullets out of your gun and stop shooting the ideologies of white supremacy disguised as truths at me. Maybe you don't mean to, maybe you do, but you can't separate intent from effects. It doesn't matter much now, because even if I've never experienced one as often as I ought to, I still write poems to my black teachers. There never were faces in your schools as they should be. My Patrice Lumumbas, my Thomas Sankaras, my Sada Shakurs, Huey Newtons, and Kwame Tours. I still dance to the heartbeat of my ancestors, when seven-year-old revolutionaries in the Congo laid down their lives for our liberation. I know the Congo cries, I cry, my mother's cry, my father's cry, so many blacks cry, but never in front of each other, always alone in rooms, rooms within rooms where caged birds sing, even in war zones. And sometimes in autumn I imagine the leaves crinkling beneath my feet, to the sounds of my ancestors, crow-feet eyes dancing and laughing again. You did not break them. You cannot break me. I know why the caged bird sings.
The caged bird sings like the saddled horse still runs wild when no one watches. I remember hearing stories of how my great-grandmother survived residential school, and now I hear stories of how the Congo survives, and I think to myself, with the combined efforts of slingshots and arrows, we will work together to take back the sky and the land. So watch out for the birds and the horses, because we cannot stop fighting. The warrior pride will not allow it. But if somehow we can come to an agreement, I can see purpose overcoming pride so that we may lay down our weapons and fire truth and love instead of lead and stone.
One day, my daughters and sons will no longer need to carry around slingshots, and you won't shoot them down with your guns. We'll just lay as human beings, studying, learning, being together. But not until you put down your lives, not until you tell the truth. Until then, this will always be a war zone.
When the time comes for us to truly be together, will we be ready? There will always be those hot-headed There will always be those whose hot-headed ideas build walls to separate us. What will you do when equality requires you to turn against your own? Can we put truth before brotherhood? When the time comes, or does what we built so hard to create tumble, like the culture destroyed by the same hands that claim to help them? If we can all agree to put the needs of those who look different other than the wants of those who look the same as you, then we will rise as humankind to levels we never dreamed could be reached. It is prophesied that one day the lamb will lie with the lion, And now is the time to decide whether that is a fairy tale or do the ships set sail for the coastline of a new tomorrow in which all cultures live together, and we use our weapons for firewood and we dance around the flame of justice, raising the universal flag of equality and respect. I believe our daughters and sons will have the strength to admit our weakness and set it aside for the furtherment of tomorrow and the betterment of humankind.